born on this earth, where you live and love and die, what is it worth? Well, I fought it all in vain, not worth the tears and pain, spending on this cold terrain. Then I met you. What a crazy place we dwell in. Our world, it's a globe we whirl pell-mell in. A sea of despair that I once fell in. But I reached the golden shore when I fell in love with you. Wide horizons, blue and shining. My dreams have a heavenly design. We kiss, and my heart goes valentine. Because we're so in love, our world is radiantly new. Because we're so
lasciami vedere, amata, non ce la faccio più. Tutto tu vuoi, niente mi dai, mi costi troppo. Non sei fatta per me.
In my career of nearly four decades in motion pictures, I've played every monstrous role it was possible for writers to create. But as you will see in the exciting film to follow, nothing invented by the human mind can be as macabre, grotesque, and thrilling as the behavior of people in so-called real life. This fellow's name is Franz Drago. He's 27 inches tall and weighs 130 pounds. His father was Spanish and his mother was Sicilian. They were in Tokyo when Franz was born. And as Japan is the land of miniatures, you can see what prenatal influence did to Franz. Drago is terrific in his specialty of imitating internationally famous popular singers. But he has to hide his great talent under the 27-inch bushel of his body, because the public is more entertained by Franz Drago's dimensions than by his imitations.
I
Atlas was a strong man, and he was reincarnated as a book of maps. Ajax was a powerhouse, and he came back as a detergent. But Hercules, mightiest of all strong men, has dozens of reincarnations, all of them working in historical, biblical, colossal films, performing superhuman exploits against the bad guys. Real heroes of the studio laborers who, at the end of each scene, have to carry away on their shoulders, without effort, uprooted columns, mountains that have been split in two, and the remains of wrecked temples.
One, two.
For generations, three, English ladies have disdained to compete with foreign beauties in putting up a front. But if Mr. Paddy Hoos is to have his way, they will soon come up from behind. Mr. Hoos's method combines physical and vocal gymnastics, which help develop the figure divine by giving new lymph and youth to bosoms that were limp and old.
One, two, three, four, five.
Bedouins, the once fierce warriors of the Sahara Desert, are now accenting the first syllable of their tribal name, B-E-D, bed. Interested tourists who watch the ancient tribal entertainments in the wandering carnivals, they offer something more than a simple variety show. For a price, Mr. Tourist follows the manager Bedouin into the tent of the owner Bedouin to make contact with the call girl Bedouin. Faithful to long-established principles, the Bedouins have given up their flocks of sheep for flocks of girls. For them, it's better to live high but briefly in this trade than 100 years of herding sheep. As you can easily see, sometimes the culture of America achieves brilliant results by following the most astonishing path.
Good evening. I am very happy to express to you, in the name of the organizing committee, warm thanks for accepting our demand. Your presence here, so numerous and compact, testifies how sensible you are to the universal problems of culture and art. As you already know, our contribution will serve a great cause. The safety of the more ancient and important ruins of a remote civilization which are threatened by the exigencies of our modern life. Ladies and gentlemen, in the name of and on behalf of the American Committee for the Safety of the Luxor Valley Monuments, I open the curtain on the showing organized by this town. I present to you Miss Virginia, Miss North Carolina, Miss South Carolina, Miss Louisiana, Miss Oregon, Miss California, Miss Utah, Miss Colorado, Miss Oklahoma, Miss Arizona, and Miss New York.
The American artistic sense competes for beauty prizes, swings along the runway, and gets inside the girls' sweaters. Contrary to the Europeans, the Americans make use of outstanding beauties as a pretext to get at artistic and cultural results, while Europeans, in cases only apparently similar, make use of artistic and cultural pretexts to get at the outstanding beauties. Oh, naturally, any reference to persons or movie producers is purely coincidental. Competition comes to an end. The money raised by these girls in well-filled sweaters will help to preserve the pyramids of ancient Egypt. Money thus flows from the temples of luxury in Las Vegas to the temples of Luxor in Egypt. All beauty contests, whether ennobled by cultural intentions or not, generally have one common characteristic. They start a great many of their winners on the road to careers in the lively arts. Like this Asiatic girl, for instance, whose job requires her to get along without a sweater, or anything else for that matter. The audience is Chinese, and it's only right that it should be. We're in Hong Kong, the doorway to China and the port of all the temptations of the Orient. The girl, however, is of mixed blood. In her veins there flows, and rather rapidly, we'd say, from the way she moves, the blood of the various races who've enthusiastically given in to the thousand temptations of Hong Kong. A splendid example of cross-breeding at a great world crossroads. A crossing at which anyone, whether he comes from the right or left, is sure to find a freeway wide open before him. The knots that bind the delicate charms of these two Chinese maidens are not difficult to untie. The man who tied them is only meeting the requirements of the staging, and his slight tendency to sadism was balanced by his worry that he might damage the merchandise. We're still in Hong Kong, in the studio of a photographer whose business is supplying layouts for magazines published for readers with special tastes. The fans of this kind of photography are very numerous in the Orient and make it possible for publishers of these specialized publications to amass fat profits that are practically incalculable. Each week, through a well-organized distribution system, the timid sadists of Hong Kong receive their ration of eroticism and torture. Always on the lookout for new acts suited to the tastes of the most sophisticated customers, the inexhaustible imagination of some Chinese nightclub owners has no bounds or limits. And every night in very private rendezvous, new kinds of diversions are offered to the insatiable curiosity of seekers of forbidden sensations. These two girls seem to be engaged in an innocent and playful wrestling match. In reality, their movements, which seem to be for defending themselves against their opponent, are carefully worked out to give the rich and offbeat spectators suggestive views and torrid prospects, calculated to arouse once more in their weary memories ancient and nebulous recollections. They are two males, and they are fighting for the domination of the herd and for the possession of the female. Ignorant of the old proverb, when two are fighting, the third enjoys the show. They are unaware of the danger lurking in the undergrowth of the savannah. The lord of the jungle is out hunting. The zebra has paid dearly for his lust for power and love. Now his carcass, with all the ambitions that were inside it, has become dinner for the king of beasts and his royal family. Tons of bone, muscle and flesh on the move. It It's an old male who all alone confronts the thousand enemies that always lie in ambush for every wild animal. One shot from a modern rifle is enough to bring down the huge beast. The Negro bearers, proud of their white hunter, are at the highest pitch of excitement and joy. The rich prey represents for them and their whole tribe a week of substantial and abundant meals. The great white hunter, on the other hand, will go away content with tales of his butchery, completely satisfied with his brilliant achievement, without forgetting, that is, to take with him as a modest and well-deserved souvenir the two precious ivory tusks of the fallen elephant. The bride is 24, the groom 81. It's not a love match. The dominating, almost imperious presence by the bride's side of the vigorous best man bears mute witness to the fact that in the case of this couple, the eternal triangle was formed even before the wedding journey. She is a professional prostitute. The groom is an inmate of an old man's home. The best man is the bride's steady companion and shares with her the profits from the oldest profession. The idea of having the young woman marry the agreeable old man for a modest compensation came from the best man, it being the only way of eliminating the danger of the girl's being sent back to the town of her birth by a police order, a measure the authorities do not adopt if the girl can write Mrs. in front of her name.
Metti su quel tango ancora, tango balordo, non cambiare disco a bordo, vieni a ballare. Della musica, quella dolce musica che ci manda in estasi senza parlare. Atmosfera languida, tango balordo, non cambiare disco amore, vieni a ballare.
This is the dream place of those women. The amusement quarter of Barcelona, the ill-famed Barrio Chino. Every night, these dark streets, barely illuminated now and then by the colored signs of night spots of every type, become the meeting place for a sampling of humanity almost always on the fringes of the law. Specimens often enriched by gentlemen on the hunt for forbidden emotions. Sometimes, by a kind of instinctive self-defense, the gentlemen who go hunting for forbidden emotions in the Barrio Chino conceal their true identity beneath a very definite disguise. And it certainly is nobody's fault if afterwards, through so many searching for forbidden sensations every night, even they can no longer distinguish between their original personality and the one beneath the disguise. We are in Munich. A group of students from the local university throw themselves into the delights of a typical German beer hall party. Student songs, beer, and a little spontaneous music are the ingredients of this get-together, which is the prelude to a ceremony that's far more cruel and stupid than the innocent and peaceful images we are viewing would suggest. The youthful hopes for the culture of the Germany of tomorrow and its governing class draw from their signs the courage necessary to confront a test which the ironclad rules of their association has rendered traditional. A battle against fear, and their faces bear the permanent signs of the fight that they endure. It's the ill-famed Mansur. Every self-respecting German student must have his face scarred by a wound received in a duel with a schoolmate. It is a wound which every self-respecting German student will show off later with pride as the undeniable proof of his courage and of maturity achieved. Nightclub in the old quarter of Berlin, which every evening gathers within its ancient walls the aristocracy of the transvestites of half Europe. In fact, it was in this club at the beginning of the century that the first exponent appeared of that fashion for wearing the opposite sex's clothes that later spread like a spot of oil to every corner of the world until it has reached its present frightening proportions.
Doch lieb ich jeden mit Bestand. Ich bin die Frau der tausend Männer. Ich bin ein Mann.
Behind this door, hidden in the back room of a modest neighborhood restaurant in Hamburg, there exists a small world of unsatisfied women who founded a club for those with special tastes, where they can meet once a week and find in companionship the courage to break away from a moral and social reality which they do not share. They are students, regularly married wives, members of the industrial middle class. There's every type and every category. And each one of them in this room, covering 50 square yards, every Saturday night, searches for what the outside world can never grant them. The freedom to consider themselves apart from and above every moral rule.
Thank you.
A humorist once said that the carnival is a strange world in which the freaks are not the people inside the booths, but the one who buy tickets to go and see them. Perhaps by taking their cue from this truth, the organizers of the Luna Park of the city of Northern Europe have invented some attractions that are absolutely original. Here is one of the novelties. The game consists of trying to pin one's opponent's shoulders to the mat. But victory is not complete if the balloons which the contenders have tied behind their backs do not explode. The game had immediate success. Also, because all the feminine spectators who so desire are free to get into the fight. The German men's passion for wrestling shows rising, unarrestable progress every night. This is a novelty at Luna Park, too. It comes from France and is called the Bridge of Marbles. The mechanism is very simple. A windpipe connected to a perforated boardwalk drives a powerful air jet upwards with scenic results of spectacular interest. Visitors, generally young couples, are more and more numerous. And amid the ribald laughter of the spectators, here, too, the sports-loving northerners continue their healthful custom of catching a breath of fresh air. For the fishermen on the island of Ceylon, today is a day of celebration. Their catch yielded all four of the great sea turtles whose tasty and juicy flesh is an exquisite delicacy to gourmets all over the world. With their forthcoming profit in mind, the men work rapidly and accurately. In a few minutes, their work is done. The same men, thinking of the turtle, mild and innocent symbol of slowness, observe that he who goes slow goes safe and far and doesn't come back. In this corner of Africa and the southern part of the Dark Continent, white men are permitted to hunt upon paying a fee, but Negroes are not. The decaying carcasses of animals with the flesh cut away and marks left by primitive men's steel on the bodies of surviving beasts bear witness, however, that among the natives the urge to break the restriction is stronger than their fear of consequences. But actually it is more likely that the natives are driven not so much by the love of hunting as by the necessity for finding food. The only ones who do not hunt in this area are the English, to whom a still confused political situation gives the right to keep watch that the local tribes do not slaughter the wildlife. In compensation, however, now and then they can have the thrill of an exciting manhunt among the Africans. After all, it's the only hunting permitted by law. On the coast of Malabar, India, a man is gravely ill and his relatives have called in a group of specialized healers. Here they are. Their exorcism, following an ancient and spectacular ritual, is intended to drive the spirits of evil out of the sufferer's body. Not only of the sick man, but also of the right. Now the sorcerer will take a chicken donated by the patient's family and devour it then and there as a symbol of the defeat of evil. It's the only moment in which the sick man displays any sign of interest. for in that chicken or in the broth he expected would be made of it, the poor patient had placed all his hopes for recovery. These people will never recover either. Their vices, which pass with complete indifference from smoking to drugs, are much stronger than their will to live. One man's vice may be another man's necessity. Cocaine, a dreaded word in decent society, is the staff of life to the Indians of Ecuador. By chewing cocoa leaves, thoroughly toasted and treated with lime, they are able to sustain any labor and forget food and the misery and sacrifice of their dreary existence. Even children learn to use the leaves before they learn to walk. The primordial theories concerning the cocoa of the underprivileged Indians of Ecuador received dramatic confirmation also in the slums of well-ordered and civilized great cities. These two women in Hong Kong, by now resigned to being captives of the vice, go through the horrors of waiting for their daily supply of cocaine and morphine. Today, the peddler is late. The distribution of the drug is carried out with sinister exactness and punctuality. In this Chinese opium den, the little pellets have arrived in time to assure the customers a brief sojourn in their artificial paradise. A paradise these men acquire at the price of their lives, which drift away piece by piece and day by day, along with the smoke of the drug they draw through the pipe stems. This is the Maharaja of Mysore, who is venerated by his subjects as a divine being because once a year he performs the miracle of making rainfall. In the minds of his subjects, the Maharaja has a continuous direct connection, hotline, with the supernatural, even if the supernatural is the office of the Weather Bureau in Calcutta. But his subjects are only interested in the rain, swelling the water of the sacred Ganges, in which they may purge themselves of their sins and those of the Maharaja. It's not the water of the sacred Ganges, but that of the swimming pool in Munich. Nevertheless, this too is a religious ceremony. It's the baptism of the new converts to the sect of Jehovah's Witnesses. The men in the white undershirts are brothers of long standing, appointed by the community to baptize the new witnesses. The religious movement called Jehovah's Witnesses, very popular in Northern Europe, grows more powerful and solid every day. Today, in Munich, their highly organized annual congress is in progress. Upon this broad pasture are gathered more than 150,000 people.
Gestern saß ich still beim Wein, voller Missvergnügen. War wohl mit dem falschen Bein aus dem Bett gestiegen. Da erklangen vor dem Tor Jugendstimmen leise. Und in mein geschärftes Ohr drang die Burschenweise Lieder der Studenten, Lieder der Erinnerung. Ihr Klang bringt die Jugend zurück und die Zeit wird wieder lebendig, die uns hinausführte ins Leben.
All Jehovah's Witnesses are firmly convinced that each one will have his special place in the new ark, which will save them from the imminent universal flood. The one thing they forget is that to save the entire congregation, the ark would need to be more or less the same dimensions as the world that is about to be destroyed. Here it looks as if the universal flood had already taken place. We are on Kuhalian, the archipelago of desolation, where every form of life has been extinguished since time immemorial. The natives who eke out an existence along the edges of the sinister swamp speak vaguely of an object which fell from the sky ages ago and plunged into the depths of the water. And since then, all plant life has withered and died, and the human inhabitants have disappeared from the region like the victims of some mysterious sorcery. Several miles long and stretches like a sinuous and evil snake across the entire city, dividing at one at the same time the hearts of the German people and two civilizations in perpetual discord. The wall was constructed several years ago in a single night by thousands of soldiers, police and citizens of the eastern sector. It's a little less than 2 yards high, but it is impassable. On the eastern side, from which the most frequent escape attempts are made, armed sentinels stand guard day and night under orders to prevent, at whatever cost, any East Berliner from passing over to the western sector. During the years that the wall has divided the citizens of the same city, and sometimes mothers from their children and brothers from brothers, the chronicle is rich in desperate and courageous episodes. One of these, which occurred recently, borders on the prodigious. A young man carried his fiancée and his future mother-in-law to the western sector by hiding them in the trunk of an automobile, a topless sport model selected purposely because of its low slung body. He approached the checkpoint and dashed through the various obstacles in the car from which he had removed the windshield. With a lightning-like maneuver, he drove under the barrier and into the western sector. Since that time, the authorities have added vertical bars to the barrier to discourage other desperate escape attempts. Sometimes, however, Lady Luck is not so generous. In Brennauer Strasse, where the wall cuts several buildings in two, silence reigns as in places dedicated to the most sacred memories. Here, where the possibilities for escape offered by windows and roofs seemed greater, fate has taken a more bitter toll of those who, with an act of rebellion, have tried to free themselves from the most fatuous limitation imposed by man upon his brothers. That of human liberty. There is a wall here too. It was erected by the city government of Naples so as not to offend the eyes of tourists and the fastidious inhabitants of the elegant neighborhoods with the sight of this shanty town founded some years ago by a group of homeless citizens. In contrast with the Berlin Wall, though, there are no sentinels standing guard at the one in Naples. Anyone may pass in at will through its various breaches and take a look at the shanty town and its inhabitants. And up to now, numbers of curious visitors have penetrated its barrier, with the exception perhaps of those who should have done so as an official duty. Signor Antonio, up to a short time ago, he confesses it himself, followed the difficult and dangerous profession of smuggling. His activity, which, if we don't go in for subtleties, might be regarded as an affirmation of free enterprise against monopoly, assured a rapid and regular source of supply to all the cigarette black markets in Naples. Now, he says, he's given up his dangerous profession. And if he carries out one of his operations once more, it is only, he says, to serve the cause of cinema entertainment. In fact, Signor Antonio agreed to reconstruct one of his operations for us and show us the salient phases of the complex activity which kept smuggled cigarettes pouring into the booming Neapolitan markets. The packages, naturally, for this demonstration do not contain cigarettes.
Aspetta, aspetta un momento. Piano, John. Vai, vai. A poi acqua, va, acqua.
He says, you see, I left the sacks here. 3 or 4 days later, when things calmed down, I came and got them. The revenue was passed, but their boats were too high to come in here. What do you say? With that face, do you believe he won't come back in 3 or 4 days this time too? The merchandise brought into Naples by the various Antonios ends up in the Forcella market, one of the busiest and best stocked in southern Italy. Here one can find just about everything, and it's highly probable that the foreign ministers of the various interested nations got the first idea of the common European market right here. In fact, the way the common market functions is merely an imitation, and not even a completely successful one, of the modern and extremely well-stocked market of Forcella. In Naples, the cult of the dead is very lively. When a difficult situation arises, the Neapolitans have recourse to the dead. They call upon them for everything. The success of a business deal, the recovery of a friend, the death of an enemy, a happy marriage, wealth. The most frequent request is for 3 numbers to play the lottery. As a matter of fact, in Naples, when a loved one dies, the idea of mourning is closely tied in with playing the lottery. This widow still expects her husband to support her, though he's long since dead. She's imploring him to put her on the track of money. Once they are interpreted and technically selected, the Neapolitan's dreams are transformed into numbers. And then, if the numbers are not drawn, there's no great harm done. A week passes quickly and one can always play again. Nothing in the world could prevail on the Neapolitans to give up their weekly ration of illusion. The attempt to solve personal problems with a winning lottery ticket becomes a reason in some cases to go on living. Naples is the home of the evil eye. A fairly common profession is that of the incense spreader, who goes about the streets entering houses and shops with his improvised tin censer spreading perfumed smoke. In Naples, many people believe in the evil eye. But out of evil comes good for those who earn their livelihood by spreading incense against the ominous orb. Ridiculous as it may seem, some superstitious people think that luck can be theirs by breaking a wishbone. Others can't pass a hunchback without asking to rub his spine to bring them luck. We're on the stage of a small vaudeville theatre. The company, almost complete, is rehearsing the numbers for a new show. They're very proud of their featured dancer, Rudy. He believes that he is the living reincarnation of Rudolph Valentino. He was born the night that Valentino died, and nightly in this small theater he performs the legendary lover's famous tango. Smug expression seems to assume that a sigh will rise from females in the audience, and he won't be happy until a woman in black throws flowers on his grave. It's dawn in a southern Italian town. In this town in the deep south, attachment to the earth has deep, almost legendary origins.
Colpa della musica, quella dolce musica. Se ti chiedo e supplico, fammi ballare. Metti su quel tango ancora, tango balordo. Non cambiare disco amore.
Aware of the necessity for fertilizing the fields, entire families cooperate during the night in accumulating a considerable quantity of fertilizer, which will help towards the production of a more bountiful annual harvest. The service for collecting the raw material works to perfection. For these people, the word plumbing has an abstract meaning, almost suggesting science fiction. So, for the present, this is the only method of solving the needs of the sun.
Colpa della musica, quella dolce musica, che ci manda in estasi, senza parlare. Atmosfera languida, tango balordo. cambiare disco, amor, vieni a ballar.
Here too, day by day, private enterprise makes notable progress. This boy prefers to ignore the public collector, and perhaps, without being aware of it, applies the sound commercial principle which eliminates any middleman between producer and consumer. Via Barghouta, the street of the Roman artists, modern bohemians with automobiles and bank accounts, every year opens its courtyards full of garages and attics with central heating to poor artists, to those who haven't yet achieved success or at least have exhibited a stylish gallery. So every year for several days in this famous street, the so-called Artists' Fair is held for painters still struggling upwards. Among these men and women, who sometimes are men and women only by virtue of their birth certificates, are hidden the future talents which will enrich tomorrow's culture with their works. And while they wait to write their names in the great album of glory, they refine their sensibilities and gatherings upon a high cultural level. It's well known that artists are always considered free of the prejudices and inhibitions which restrain the instincts of ordinary people. For some time, however, the youthful dissipation of the past has given way to manifestations which resemble less and less an affirmation of rebellion against conformity. Since the time of the existentialists, the path of modern art passes more and more often and more willingly through experiences like this. Certain works of modern art, as all know, hardly have to go on sale before they are snapped up. And the snapping up is generally done by the members of the vice squad. Most absolute respect for the proverb which says the dog is man's best friend and woman is the dog's best friend, the modish ladies of the capital are noted for the particular attention they devote to their charming and faithful canine friends. If the faithful canine has the symptoms of a tumor, especially if it is far advanced, its mistress, without a thought of expense, has an operation performed at once. No ordinary veterinarian will do. The dog must have the attention of a medical man of at least the status of Dr. Casey. When this Casey goes to bat, the result is a miracle cure. In the well-equipped dormitory of the specialized clinic, all are the purest thoroughbreds. They are lovingly cared for by the nurses and their mistresses, who see to it that they keep warm and are as comfortable as possible. They've caught cold or have a slight inflammation of the stomach, or perhaps the measles and the mumps. The old saying, a dog's life, is losing its bite. It's enough to consider that every day the existence of these charming little beasts is becoming more like that of human beings. Among other things, even men are sometimes run over by an automobile.
Mm-hmm.
And here are a few almost too obvious demonstrations that the difference between men and animals is, in some cases, at least from a formal and external point of view, very subtle and problematic. What did we say? Before this cage, what difference is there between this sprightly but possibly denuded old gentleman and the immensely dignified oak? In the heart of Arabia, camels are useful not only as tireless bearers of men and merchandise, the abundant consequences of their boundless thirst are collected in special receptacles and used by the local hairdressers as an effective rinse to make the young and pretty Arab girls turn blonde. The miracle is accomplished. The delicate operation is completely successful. The Indians have not yet discovered the liquid generosity of the camel, and in dressing their hair, they make use of the dyeing propensities of a certain type of berry. Thank you. laughing at these hairdos. Think well upon modern hairstyling and the faces of the young people in our own country. When a young Papuan decides to get married, he must ask his future mother-in-law instead of his sweetheart's father for the hand of his bride. These Papuan villages are matriarchates. Therefore, the women rule the roost. We are witnessing a wedding ceremony. The bridal couple are subjected to ritual treatment. They are both greased and thoroughly massaged by the oldest woman in the village, who has previously instructed the bride as to the significance of the nuptial rite and the duties it imposes. Not an easy task when one considers that the marriageable age for Papuan girls ranges from 8 to 12 years. Here, an 18-year-old unmarried girl is already a sour old maid. When the matrimonial ceremony is over, the married couple withdraw into the hut with the old folks for company, while the rest of the village abandons itself to frenzied celebration of the wedding feast. Two women begin the dancing with a ritual ballet, the movements of which signify that woman is queen because she conceals within her the mystery of life. Immediately afterwards, it's the men's turn. With the permission of the old women, today the Papuan husbands can go off the leash for a while. Men and women masked by these strange headdresses dance together and coupled without knowing the identity of their partners. These are native dance customs. It all depends on what part of the world you are a native of. In the wilds of the island of Haiti, it's the Macumba. In a modern nightclub, it's rock and roll. Can we, from the height of our civilization, truly call one primitive and the other cultivated?
Un'anima violetta, lei mi chiede un teddy boy, sì sì, un teddy boy, sì sì. Ha preso ormai la gotta, ma aggredisce le coppiette, un teddy boy, sì sì, un teddy boy, sì sì. La nonna lo riprende, il nonno si difende, dicendo moglie mia, sono teddy boy, mio nonno teddy boy, sa ballare. Yes, 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 mio nonno
In the Jamaican quarter of London, a usage prevails which can only seem eccentric to our eyes, used to more severe customs. When a man cannot support a woman by himself, he forms an association with several friends to make a kind of consortium. Thus a woman will have four or five husbands who support her together and enjoy her charms by turns. In order not to disturb the intimacy of the little Jamaican family, we pointed our lens through the window. Domestic peace reigns serenely, and the woman feels perfectly at ease beneath the gaze of her four husbands. Until a short time ago, this woman had five husbands. But it's not easy to look after five men, and the poor creature was driven by necessity to give up the fifth. here's another way of showing a love for nature. The tourists say that life in the open has its advantages. You sleep in the pure air of the pine woods. You breathe the fresh ozone of the sea. And you're not a captive of the demands of city life. And more important, you don't have to pay a hotel bill. For their part, the young people, who no doubt agreed reluctantly to follow their aging parents on the rough trail of camp life, always find a way to keep boredom away. Here's a group of them engrossed in a recently invented game. A blindfolded fellow must recognize the girl he has kissed by the touch of her lips and her personal technique. If he guesses wrong, he loses and must pay a forfeit. But if he recognizes both the technique and the girl, then, well, we can't say exactly what his prize will be. When we asked the girls about it, they blushed without reply. However, there's one consolation. At least they blushed. If kids take their spicy game seriously, imagine how grown-ups behave. Watch. This pastime is the craze of England. It's called hoodwink, and the players have to guess the identity of the girl who's been chosen from among the feminine acquaintances of the male contestants. When one of the players guesses the name of the girl, she has to take off her hood, and with a wink, she goes off with a lucky man. As in all parlor games, the quiz has its weak point, too. Sometimes it happens that the same girl is called by two, three, or even four spectators. But this only makes it more interesting.
That's the clip that I always get. Now she's getting more familiar. And the gesture, the movement. Wait, Joan. No, it's Carol. Not Joan. Well, I don't think she knows who it is. What party did we meet? You don't know, huh?
I must confess, she fooled me completely. I couldn't understand who she was.
Oh,
another hangman's lady.
The return of the hangman's lady.
Well, let's see. She looks a little more familiar than the other one.
Yes, she does.
Yeah, I like her.
Very natty slip. As I always say, many a slip between the cup and the lip.
I hope you don't say it very often.
Oh, not too often. Yeah. Now, let's see. Now, this one begins with the left leg.
Oh, well, now, my wife always begins with the right leg. I don't know.
Ah,
well, so,
this is not your wife.
Couldn't be.
Oh, no, that's mine.
Here we go.
Oh, no, you're not. No, this is mine.
Uh-huh. No, it begins to look a little more familiar.
Where did we meet this one? Was it the Folie Bergère?
Could have been there. Yes, it could have.
I didn't recognize that bank.
Oh, what a back.
Huh?
Oh, wait a minute. I see something familiar. Joan!
This time, everything was fine. Out of three customers, only two guessed right. Luckily, man's great moving force, love, still keeps its romantic flavor against all odds. Though times have changed and it's no longer the rattling of a carriage but the muffled purr of a motor that forms the background to the murmurings of sweet nothings, the sight of two lovers whispering tender phrases has remained unchanged. A truly moving and heartwarming sight, which, however, is spied upon from time to time by some stealthy spectator. Here you see some of them caught by our lens after a long and patient wait. They are voyeurs, or watchers, the unfortunate outsiders looking in on love. As opposed to the professionals, the amateur voyeur, even if no longer young, can satisfy their taste at very little cost. Naturally, they can't expect much. This kind of show might bear the slogan, "If you like it, enjoy it." Those little machines don't have many customers in the summertime. Then the amateur boyer wants something with more life, something more tangible. And they go looking for it on the beaches, always full of pretty girls. There they go, swinging their hips with every moving part in tip-top or tip-bottom condition. Their easy movement puts to shame the finest mechanical device assembled by man. The rhythmic motion has a hypnotic effect. They attract all eyes. Their conquest is complete. They dominate the sea. Sometimes after the ingenues, the special attractions show up. When the muscle boys and more or less genuine tourists reach an agreement, they need only to choose a base of operations. It's not really a difficult problem. When they go home, the girls from the northern countries will tell their friends that in Italy, the problem of the relations between the sexes is still all at sea. Like this gentleman, for instance. Inspiration for painters who try mostly in vain to capture the astonishing colors on canvas. Muse of songwriters who voice their despair at ever finding another place its equal. Attraction for tourists who revel in its sun, sea, and sensuous splendor. The island of Capri beckons to visitors from both hemispheres to shed the problems of reality and escape in the fantasy world created by nature in a generous mood in the Bay of Naples. None of the many elements of an unforgettable vacation is lacking here, and they are carefully listed in the folders distributed by the travel agencies. Sun, sea, local color, the Fragilioni, deluxe hotels, and the typical narrow streets. In addition, here there are the fishermen, and famous fishermen of Capri. Hello, what are you doing?
I take the American tourist ladies out for a boat ride.
You too?
Sure.
With a woman?
Of course.
Thank you.
Okay.
At dawn, the boats return. Tonight, they didn't go fishing, but their night's work was just as hard, even though well paid. For the young Capri fisherman, it was a normal business deal. A job just like any other, not worth bragging about to his friends at the bar. But for her, it's a different matter. Something of this night on the sea will remain with her. In time, she will idealize the boy from Capri. She'll think of him as handsome, stronger, and above all, less commercial. As she recounts her adventure to her friends, what was little more than a casual encounter will lose much of its brutality and become a wonderful night of love beneath the starlit sky of the most beautiful island in the world. This too is a safety valve for modern man. Here, after a week of self-control, personal discipline, inhibitions and repressions, men and women finally abandon themselves to their instincts and give free rein to the charge of physical and nervous energy accumulated during the rest of the week. But even the passion for sport, like all man's other pastimes, moves aside and bows low before arguments of greater weight and substance. Ah, yes, the eye demands its share, too. There you have it. As they say in Italian, Mondo Balardo. It's really a crazy world. Sincerely, Boris Karloff.
Lasciami perdere. Amata! Non ce la faccio più. Tu vuoi, niente mi dai, mi costi troppo, non sei fatta per me. Il mondo vorresti comprare, con te non si può ragionare, e io continuo a pagare, ora sai che non sei proprio matta. Lasciami perdere, matta, non ce la faccio più. Tutto tu vuoi, niente mi dai, mi costi troppo, non sei fatta per me.